Morning, Your Honors, and may it please the court. My name is Samuel Weiss, and I represent the appellant, Mr. Richard Munoz. I'd like to reserve 4 minutes for rebuttal. The district court granted summary judgment to defendants on Munoz's ADA claim on a single ground, that there was no genuine question of material fact on whether Munoz had a qualifying disability under the ADA. That opinion was obviously wrong, as it relied on law that Congress explicitly abrogated in the 2008 ADA Amendments Act. Defendants do not defend the district court's decision, which alone makes reversal appropriate. Instead, they argue for affirmance on one of two alternative grounds, but neither is correct. First, defendants argue that Munoz is bringing a claim for inadequate medical treatment, not a failure to accommodate a disability. But permission to sleep on a lower bunk is a paradigmatic disability accommodation. It does not medically treat knee injuries any more than a wheelchair ramp treats paralysis. Second, defendants argue that Dr. Meisner-Frisk was not deliberately indifferent to a risk of disability discrimination, even though she herself testified that removing a low bunk chrono without examining the patient is inappropriate. I'll address each issue in turn. First, Munoz's low bunk chrono was not medical treatment, but instead a disability accommodation. Defendants invoke an atextual exception to the ADA from this court's opinion in Simmons versus Navajo County, which states that the ADA does not treat inadequate treatment for a disability, that is, medical care meant to lessen the medical issue causing the disability. Although there's no statutory basis or Supreme Court precedent to support this, the operating principle is that Congress could not have intended to replace existing medical malpractice type claims by turning them all into ADA claims. That principle, however, cannot extend beyond medical treatment to disability accommodations, which is the very core of the ADA. And it's the latter that's clearly at issue here. This court stated in Armstrong that accessible beds are disability accommodations. Dr. Meisner-Frisk herself testified multiple times that low bunk chronos are disability accommodations. The Department of Justice has issued regulations stating that safe, appropriate housing is required under the ADA. This court in Pierce versus County of Orange stated that adequate bedding claims are within the scope of the ADA. And all of this authority comports with the plain text of the relevant terms. Permission to sleep on a lower bunk is not medical treatment. It is a disability accommodation that allowed Mr. Munoz to access the program, service, or activity of a safe place to sleep, despite his substantial limitations on his ability to climb.
Yes, but counsel, isn't the heart of your claim the failure to recognize that there was a disability?
Yes, Your Honor, that's true.
And that was a medical determination?
Well, yes, Your Honor, although Dr. Meisner-Frisk testified that all disability accommodations are made by doctors. So defendants don't invoke any authority for this idea that if a doctor says you don't have a disability accommodation, then you're not obligated to provide one. Now, the knowledge of the doctor does become relevant at deliberate indifference, which we can discuss. But the elements of an ADA claim are having a disability, having an actual disability, and having that, which is, you know, there are several ways to qualify as disabled, but actual disability is one of them. And then having that disability not be reasonably accommodated. So that's adequate to state an ADA claim on its own. So saying that if a doctor testifies that she does not believe that he has accommodation, then that puts you outside the context of the ADA entirely. That would blow this giant hole in the ADA in jails and prisons, despite Supreme Court precedent and this court's precedent insisting that it applies. And I would argue also that it's a particularly odd argument for defendants to make here, because they actually concede the issue that there is a material question that he was disabled. So even though it was their primary argument below, and even though it was the sole basis of the district court's decision, defendants argue that no matter how disabled he was, and no matter how unreasonable the accommodation, if a doctor says that I made a medical determination that this person was not disabled, courts are not allowed to peek behind the curtain at all. And there's just no statutory basis for that in the text of the ADA. It goes against the purpose of the ADA, which is as a broad remedial statute to stamp out disability discrimination. And it's in conflict with the 2008 amendment to the ADA, which had to revise the ADA to stop courts from creating creating atextual exceptions to keep people out of the ADA entirely. Any concerns that Dr. Meisner-Frisk had would become relevant at the reasonableness of an accommodation stage. It would also become relevant here because this case is for damages of the deliberate indifference. But what defendants are arguing is something different. It's that no matter, it wouldn't matter that if Munoz was in a wheelchair, and it doesn't matter how wrong, it doesn't matter how unreasonable the accommodation, if a doctor says, I don't think you had a disability, then you are kept out of the ADA framework entirely. And that goes against the whole statutory framework of the ADA, which is supposed to focus on the reasonableness of the defendant's conduct and not creating formalistic obstacles.
Did the doctor say that he didn't have a disability or that he didn't need this particular accommodation?
I'm sorry, I couldn't quite hear that.
Did the doctor say that he didn't have a disability or he didn't need this particular accommodation? He didn't.
I don't know, that's not clear.
But did she ever say he has no disability?
I'm not sure if she did. It was obviously defendant's main argument below, and it was the district court's sole basis of decision. But because the evidence in the medical records is so overwhelming that he did have a disability, defendants don't even defend that district court decision.
I know, but I'm just asking what this particular doctor said.
Yeah, the doctor said that I think it's fair to say that she said that he had no disability. She testified that she looked at his medical records and his medical records were normal, is what she testified in her deposition. And if you look at his medical records are replete with a history of knee surgery, him begging again and again and again for a low bunk chrono, him eventually obtaining one, even though she testified that you can only obtain a low bunk chrono by verifying.
What she said in her declaration is, plaintiff did not display any sign that he was severely impaired or had severe pain. And I determined that plaintiff did not have a disability, but that's whether he had a disability for which he needed or qualified for a low bunk chrono. Those don't sound like medical determinations, they sound like legal determinations.
Right, I think that's correct, Your Honor.
And then my other question, the ADA amendments, I'm sort of mystified by this, and it may not be at all relevant, but there actually was no amendment to the definition of disability, was there?
That's true, except it did things like laying out rules of construction, that they must be read as broadly as possible. It did, specifically state that the decisions in Toyota Motor Manufacturing, which was the sole basis.
That's also a really strange way to sort of legislate a change, because, for a legislature, we don't like this opinion, but we're not going to do anything to change the statute because of the opinion. It's a little peculiar.
I agree with that, Your Honor, but I think it's what
but
it's setting.
We have case law saying that the Toyota standard is no more. Is that right?
Yeah, there is.
Yeah. So what you're arguing for is, as I understand it, you want damages.
Yes, Your Honor.
That flow from the injury that was sustained because he had a high bunk?
Correct.
And so the determination that you are upset with is the determination by the doctor that he didn't qualify for a low bunk chrono.
Yeah, I would say it's less the determination than the revocation of the low bunk chrono. So it's the actually taking it away. That may be a pedantic distinction.
Okay, so do we look to the deliberate indifference standard for that?
Yes, Your Honor, we do.
And how do you show deliberate indifference?
Well, Your Honor, in a few different ways. I think, first of all, I would just remind ourselves of the procedural posture. We're on summary judgment. Inferences need to be made in favor of Mr. Munoz, and I think perhaps the most striking fact is that Dr. Meisner-Frisk herself testified that it was inappropriate to take away a low bunk chrono without personally examining somebody. defendants characterize this sometimes as something like bureaucratic slippage. You know, negligence is not enough. There needs to be, and the deliberate indifference in the context of the ADA is different than in the Eighth Amendment. It's knowledge of and disregarding a risk of a violation of federal law, a violation of the ADA. So, which is to say, a violation of, you know, a failure to accommodate, basically. And here, Dr. Meisner-Frisk testified that she reviewed his medical records and they were normal. And again, we do these string sites, you know, there's one on page 10 of our reply brief, time and time and time and time after again, where the medical records are not normal. They demonstrate, he says over and over, my knees lock up on a ladder, and he begged for years to get a low bunk chrono, which of course benefits him in absolutely no way other than it's safer. So she testified that she reviewed those records. So she knew, she saw all these records that were full of issues that required a low bunk chrono. And she also knew that a previous doctor had given him a permanent low bunk chrono. And she testified that disabilities are verified before ever giving a low bunk chrono. So she knew that a previous doctor looked at the exact same evidence and said, yes, we gave him a low bunk chrono. Perhaps most critically, she did not examine him. She relied on incredibly unreliable information. She said, well, I saw him twice and he seemed fine to me, basically. Those two appointments had absolutely nothing to do with his knee pain. She even testified, I didn't examine his gait. And she also testified that even if you were able to ambulate correctly, that has nothing to do necessarily with your ability to climb. You know, I'll also note that another thing the medical records are full of is him begging for an MRI, which is the only way that would reveal ligament damage. And a doctor actually ordered him an MRI, and then it was canceled by CDCR's administration. So the idea that there's some objective evidence, you know, she says, I looked and the x-rays were okay. He didn't say that he had bone damage. He said that he had ligament damage. So the question is, did she know of a risk of a failure to accommodate and disregard it? And the answer is yes. I think that's clear, even setting aside the summary judgment standard, where here deliberate indifference is typically a fact-intensive inquiry that is more appropriate for a fact finder. But here, the evidence that she was aware of a risk and disregarded it is overwhelming.
The district court only decided the disability question, and he did it. You submit on the wrong standard, is that
yes.
Right? One possibility is we just say that and send the case back.
That's, Your Honor, that is one possibility. I would just note one thing, which is we haven't discussed a lot the distinction between medical treatment and disability accommodations, but I would just note that Simmons versus Navajo County has been cited a couple of dozen times by this court, every single time in an unpublished case, typically in one sentence, and in pro se cases that go against incarcerated plaintiffs. So I would say, and it's true, defendants cite a couple of these cases in their brief, that a couple of them frankly do blur the line a little bit between medical care and disability accommodations. So I would say last year, a district court in the Third Circuit analogously dismissed a case on Bryant versus Madigan, which Simmons, the Seventh Circuit case that Simmons versus Navajo County cited. And the Third Circuit reversed and said, no, there's a difference here. We can't just chuck out disability cases by defendants invoking that what's a disability accommodation is actually medical treatment. It's very analogous to this case. That was an accessible shower instead of an accessible bed. So I would say, of course, that is one option, reversing on that basis. But I would also say that I think that this court and the district courts could use some delineation in a published opinion between disability accommodations like this one and actual medical treatment. And I'll reserve.
You're down to about 30 seconds to reserve.
Sure, thank you.
Mr. Miller?
May it please the court, Byron Miller on behalf of Defendants Appellees, California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation, and Dr. Meisner-Frisk. Dr. Meisner-Frisk found that Munoz did not have a disability or physical impairment that required a lower bunk. That was her medical determination, and under this court's precedent.
Is that a medical determination or is that a legal determination? I mean, she, in the sentence I read before, said what she thought disability meant, which is arguably not consistent with the post-Toyota standard. And then she said he didn't have it, and therefore didn't need to have the lower bunk. But was that a medical determination? I mean, the problem here seems to be that because he's in prison, he has no access to outside doctors see what his actual medical condition is or whether he has a disability. So now he has an internal doctor who seems to be both a clinician but also the person assigned to determine which whether accommodations are needed. And it was in the second hat, as I understand it, that she was seeing, that she made the decision about Mr. Munoz. Is that right?
So yes, and it was a medical determination. CDCR assigned her to review these lower bunk chronos. So that was the whole
thing. Whether or not they needed a particular accommodation. It wasn't
that's
really
right.
Called what his medical condition was or to give him treatment or anything like that.
Well, they had a medical doctor do the review so that they could look at the medical evidence. You know, she was the doctor who could look at all of his medical records. And she was the one who was able to make that determination. And at CDCR, that's how it works. All accommodations, generally, they go through a medical physician who is going to look at whether they need. And we can think of it as like a prescription.
But that's not true in a normal, I mean, outside of the prison context, those two roles are usually divorced, right? You have a doctor making medical determinations, and then you have an HR person or an employer or somebody deciding which accommodation, going through the process of deciding which accommodations are necessary. Here, you have a medical doctor doing it, but really not qua medical doctor exam.
I mean, perhaps in the outside world, an employer would want a physician to verify whether an accommodation was needed, and a medical doctor could look at the medical evidence and decide whether it was required or not. But if we look at Simmons, I think that provides controlling on-point precedent, because in that case, it was medical staff at a county jail that put Simmons on suicide watch, which meant he didn't have access to outdoor recreation and other programs. Simmons then committed suicide, and his parents sued under the ADA, alleging that his suicide was a result of not having access to outdoor exercise and those programs to treat his depression. But this court held that the deprivation of, quote, programs or activities to lessen his depression was not actionable under the ADA. So by analogy, just as in Simmons, where there was no ADA liability based on the medical determinations about what services or programs that inmate needed for his depression, there can't be liability under the ADA here, because this case is based on Dr. Meisner Frisk's medical decision regarding what accommodation he needed for his knee.
This is not what the district court decided. You're not defending what the district court decided.
No, that's correct. The district court didn't decide it, and we aren't defending what the district court ordered on whether there was a disability. And we're not saying that there was no disability. I mean, there's all sorts of disabilities that he might have had. But all we're arguing is that she determined that he didn't have a disability that required a lower bunk. And that was her medical judgment. In Bryant v. Madigan, which this court cited to in Simmons, it has facts that are even more close to this case. In Bryant, the plaintiff alleged that he had leg spasms from his paraplegia, which caused him to fall out of his bed and break his leg. He then sued under the ADA because his request for guardrails was denied. The Seventh Circuit rejected that claim, explaining that, quote, incompetent treatment for his paraplegia was not actionable under the ADA. So whether it's a judgment.
What Mr. Weiss says is this wasn't treatment. It wasn't going to make his legs any better, unlike in Simmons, unlike in Bryan. It was simply an accommodation. It wasn't going to improve his leg. That wasn't the point of it. It wasn't it wasn't a medical treatment.
Well, it wasn't. It was a medical determination about what he needed, though.
But that's different than the other cases in which what was being looked at was in Simmons, for example, was should he have had a different treatment for his depression than he did?
That's correct. So in Simmons, they looked at, I mean, the doctors, the medical staff needed to make a decision. Well, if he's suicidal, do we keep him on suicide watch? Is that going to be better for him? Or is it going to be better for him to be out, you know, programming with the other inmates?
In terms of improving his depression.
Yes, but exactly.
What's going on here? Nothing that's going on is going to help his needs. It's simply accommodating a situation.
And that was just the case in Bryant v. Madigan, which was more similar, where it was a guardrail. You know, the guardrail was an accommodation. So the medical professionals couldn't be liable for whether he needed that or not. And that's the case that this court cited to in Simmons. And, you know, to Munoz's counsel's point about whether this is going to abrogate the ADA entirely in prisons and jails, it's not. Since the Simmons decision in 2010, this court has repeatedly and consistently found that medical denials of accommodations in prison aren't actionable under the ADA. Those are unpublished cases, and they're cited on page 15 and 17 of the answering brief, but they include medical denials of shoes for flat feet, medical denial of magnifying glass for poor eyesight, medical denial of a typewriter for a finger injury. So that's how this court has repeatedly interpreted Simmons. And all those decisions applying the Simmons rule, they don't abrogate the ADA in prisons. For example, if a medical doctor makes the decision that an accommodation is needed to treat a disability, but then the inmate goes out and the officers in the prison discriminate by refusing to provide that accommodation, well, that might be an ADA violation, but that's not the case we have here, where there was an underlying determination about whether he needed it to begin with.
But the medical role here was to go through the medical records, I take it.
That's right, Your Honor.
And was this, we heard reference in your adversary's argument to complaints that he couldn't climb. Were those in the medical records that were reviewed?
They were. There were his subjective complaints that he couldn't climb, but, you know, she also looked at other physicians' opinions that he didn't need, you know, the lower bunk. She also looked at the objective evidence, his x-rays. And to clarify, what she actually testified was that it's possible that an x-ray wouldn't show ligament damage, but it could show whether further testing needed to occur. She looked at the evidence. She's the medical professional. I can't really analyze those
documents. I gather she was just totally wrong. When you finally had the MRI, you did have all these problems with his knee.
Well, the MRI came after he fell, and his theory is he fell out of the bunk and then tore his ACL, and then that's the injury, you know, that he's suing for.
The meniscus problems and so on.
I'm sorry, what was that, Your Honor?
Also, some meniscus problems that showed up in the MRI and so on.
That's right. From my understanding, he blames those problems on the fall. I'm not a doctor. I couldn't tell if they were pre-existing or not. But the point was that Dr. Meisner-Frisk was the doctor, and she looked at all of the evidence, and she came to a medical determination. I mean, we can look at the lower bunk chrono as a type of a prescription that a doctor writes. There's a special form that the medical staff use to decide whether there's a medical necessity for the accommodation.
Well, if somebody can't climb, and the difference between an upper bunk and a lower bunk is that you have to climb into the upper bunk, then how do you justify simply ignoring that complaint? Since a lot of the other records don't have anything to do with the specific problem that we're dealing with here.
And Your Honor, the policy wasn't to ignore this. It was to have a medical doctor look at the issue, and that's what happened here. And she looked at it, and you know, obviously Munoz argues that it was unjustifiable. Well, you know, maybe he has a cause of action under, you know, inmates in that position, they're not shut out of court. There's the Eighth Amendment, there's an avenue, and they also have medical negligence. And Munoz, in fact, he still has his medical negligence, or his negligence claim, that's left intact. That was the court denied or didn't exercise jurisdiction over that claim.
Counsel, what do you do with the district court citation to Toyota Motors?
Your Honor, I mean, as Munoz pointed out in the opening brief, there is a different interpretation of what qualifies as a disability now. But you know, our point that's really irrelevant to our point. Our point is, you know, whether Dr. Meisner-Frist determined that he had a disability or some type of impairment that required the lower bunk. So it kind of goes to the underlying determination about whether he had the disability at all.
But doesn't that same problem infect her determination? Because when you read what her determination was, I read it before, I'm not sure I can find it again, but it incorporates a notion of severity, which is not, in other words, there's a legal element to what she decided. And she seems to have made essentially the same error that the district court did.
Dr. Meisner-Frist, she's not a lawyer. I mean, what she says is a disability.
That's right. She's not a lawyer, but here it is again. What she said was, based on this review and my previous examinations and observations of plaintiff did not display any sign that he was severely impaired or had severe pain, and I determined that he did not have a disability from which he needed or qualified for a lower bunk chrono. So her determination, is essentially a legal determination. And that's what she was assigned to do, was to make a legal determination, to decide whether he required an ADA accommodation or not.
It definitely had legal implications, but you know, what she was assigned to do was make sure that inmates who had lower bunk assignments really needed them. It was basically an audit, right, by a medical doctor. Medical doctors did this audit to see what did they really need.
What I'm saying is, she used the term, he was not severely impaired. Is that consistent with the post-Toyota law? Severely impaired.
Well, if you're talking about disability generally, no, not in abstract sense.
Right.
But
so she was applying a legal standard, which was the wrong legal standard, just as the district court did, as to whether he had a disability which needed or qualified for a low bunk chrono.
So what she was doing is applying that standard to a very specific need. Disability is defined broadly. That's what we're supposed to do now, is look at disability very broadly. But she's not looking at, he might very well be disabled. He might have all sorts of disabilities. He might be unable to do other types of activities, but she looked at it and decided he didn't have the type of impairment or severe impairment that would prohibit him from getting up to the upper bunk. So that's what she decided. And you know, that kind of goes into the deliberate indifference element, which is, you know, even if you take Munoz's, all of his facts, the way he presents them in his brief as true, we'll accept all of them. But that still doesn't amount to deliberate indifference, because what this court said in Duvall, you're supposed to look at whether there was a quote, fact-specific investigation. And so both Duvall and Updike, which was also cited in the reply brief, they provide examples of what was not sufficient. So in Duvall, there was no fact-specific investigation because the plaintiff asked for real-time court reporting so that he could read what was happening in his trial. But when he asked for it, the county employees, quote, failed to investigate whether it was available. They, quote, made no effort to contact court reporting firms to see if they could provide it, and they didn't look into whether their courtroom could even accommodate that type of technology. Same thing in Updike, that provides another example of no investigation where the plaintiff needed a sign language interpreter for his arraignment, but the defendants produced, quote, no evidence that they ascertained what accommodations might be needed. So they couldn't get out on summary judgment on deliberate indifference either. But the court in Updike came to the opposite conclusion with respect to the state defendants. The state defendants didn't look at the right document in the plaintiff's file that showed he needed an interpreter, and so they didn't order one for him. But there was at least some sort of fact-finding attempt.
Another question about the doctor and whether what she did was a medical determination.
Yes.
She relied very heavily on this, she said she got from a correctional officer. Was that a medical determination? Aside from the fact that she had no idea who it was or what he was supposed to be doing or anything else, her reliance on the fact that somebody saw him playing sports, was that a medical determination?
She considered that in making a medical determination. That was part of her fact-specific inquiry. So I know Munoz says, oh, it wasn't, he calls into question the accuracy of that report, but there's no dispute that she considered it. She considered that, she considered his records. She took into consideration her personal observations. And same thing, while it's true that she wasn't specifically examining his knee during those visits, she could think back about whether he was complaining about the knee, whether he showed signs of pain, or whether he was showing signs of impairment, and she determined that he wasn't. So those were all part of her medical determination, the facts that she looked over. And so that's why, you know, it doesn't fall within the ADA, but even if it does, it shows that that was a fact-specific investigation, which was, you know, much more than, you know, what the state defendants in Updike did. I see my time is out, Your Honor.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
Here for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just a few very brief points. So Judge Berzon is absolutely right about the language Mr. Miller quoted in Simmons. The outdoor exercise lessened his depression. That was the word used in Simmons. It made him less depressed. A low bunk chrono did not heal his knees. It's
a disability. What about the Bryant case?
Yeah, so that's my second point. So the Bryant, so basically, the law about the guardrails is just simply not the law of the circuit. It is quite analogous to the situation, but it's not the law of the circuit. That decision was made on the basis that a accessible bed is not a program, service, or activity under the ADA. In fact, that opinion said, you know, the ADA probably doesn't apply in prisons at all. I'm almost certain it would be absurd. You know, the Supreme Court held otherwise 9-0 a couple of years later. But it said that an accessible bed is not a program, service, or activity. This court held in Armstrong, this court held in Pierce versus County of Orange, that an accessible bed is a program, service, or activity. So that aspect of Bryant versus Madigan has been cited one time in a published opinion in this court. It's these two sentences from Simmons versus Navajo County, and it was solely cited for the basis that medical malpractice type claims are not covered under the ADA. So the incorporation of its facts, it would be troubling for Mr. Munoz were it to be incorporated, but it can't be because it conflicts with Title II ADA DOJ regulations, which also say a safe, accessible housing is covered under the ADA, as well as several published opinions from this court. And I would just say a final point about the deliberate indifference about how the other cases are about a failure to investigate. This is precisely what we had here. She testified that she needed to examine him, that it was appropriate to examine him. She did not do so. Instead, she relied on examinations where he had absolutely no reason to bring up any of his knee issues because he had a permanent low bunk chrono. He hadn't been warned that it would be taken away. So he had absolutely no my opposing counsel said, why didn't he bring up his knee issues? Because he had a low bunk chrono at the time. He had no idea that it would be taken away with no investigation. And she specifically testified she learned nothing about his knees in those appointments. They were for totally unrelated things. And she did not observe his gait. And even if she had, observing your gait doesn't necessarily inform you about somebody's ability to climb steps. So with that, I would encourage this court to reverse the district court and remand.
Thank you, counsel. Thank you both for your arguments this morning. The case just argued will be submitted for decision. And we're going to take a short break before the next case. So we'll take 5 minutes and then we'll be back. I'm sorry, you're both eagerly waiting, I know, but we'll be back.